Foundation. The German V-2 rocket, Hitler's revenge weapon. Captured V-2 components and surrendered scientists, including Wernher von Braun, were sent to America's first center for rocket research and testing, the White Sands Missile Range.
I recall, once again, being in Rockos when shortly after the firing, we got a call from a lady who said she was calling from the corner drugstore that parts of our missile had just landed in her backyard.
Took the binoculars down just when the thing hit right at the guard gate. Wham! Blew all the windows out of postage near it. It was fun. Great fun.
What?
His name is Eduardo Galeano, one of the world's great literary figures. A Latin American who has known the brutality of military dictators.
I think and I feel and I ask myself, in which supermarket did they buy Latin America?
These stories next on Assignment with Hal Rose.
Hello. One of the most significant events of the 20th century must be man's escape from the confines of this planet. What was throughout the ages but a dream, man's space flights, had their early origins right here in this remote desert region of the American Southwest. The story is best told by those who know it best, those who were there, the pioneers of the White Sands Missile Range.
Had some real excitement with some of the rockets. I tell you, we had some spectacular blow-ups. I found pieces of rocket metal a quarter of a mile from impact. It was like shrapnel. And I said, you lie down there, it's better for it to go over than through you. You may, if you have a close hit, you might get covered up a foot of dirt, but at least you can survive.
Right.
Well, some of the work was dangerous, so we've had some close calls.
My generation, the boys that I knew, they liked tinkering with cars. Well, these boys were a generation ahead. They liked tinkering with outer space. They saw it coming, they wanted to be part of it, and they worked their hearts out for it. They'd have done it for free if somebody would have just fed them. That's how much they loved it.
In 1944, as war raged on, the Army decided at last to upgrade its artillery system with a new technology, the guided missile. Finding a proving ground large enough to test long-range missiles would not be easy. But by acquiring the relatively small area of lands which separated the Fort Bliss from the Alamogordo bombing ranges, the combined area would provide a test range of some 140 miles. And the White Sands Proving Ground was born.
Of course, the field was new, the technology was new, no one really knew what the problem was.
The early few days there at the missile range, the proving ground rather, was pretty exciting because I didn't know from nothing, and no one else did either. And we had everybody running around there and trying to figure out what we were doing.
They used to say, well, you're out in the tules, you know. Charlie and I would go back to Ohio, when they thought that we were in old Mexico, they asked if we had a visa, you know.
Even before the White Sands chapter, the story of space rocketry has begun. Germany, 1944. World War II enters its final phase as Allied air power heaps destruction upon Germany itself. In the dark of night, tons of British bombs fall on the fatherland. Come daylight, American bombers wreck their havoc. And the once invincible German Luftwaffe was by now impotent to turn the tide. Desperate in the face of the onslaught, Adolf Hitler unleashed two powerful new weapons heretofore unknown to the Allied powers. First, there was the gasoline-driven V-1 rocket, buzz bombs they were called, and they fell by the thousands upon Great Britain. Then came the V-1's even more deadly successor, the supersonic V-2 rocket. Bigger and more powerful than its cousin, the V-2 pounded Allied targets. But the world's first true ballistic missile came too late to save the Third Reich.
See, they saw that they were losing the war. And, of course, they were really scared of Russia. And so they deliberately placed themselves in a position where the American troops could capture them rather than the Russians. They did that deliberately because they feared the Russians.
Germany's loss would be America's gain. At war's end, the German scientist who had fashioned these icons in Hitler's arsenal of destruction, including the 30-year-old Wernher von Braun, would be covertly spirited out of Germany to the United States. Their destination, Fort Bliss, El Paso, Texas, just 45 miles south of what was then the White Sands Proving Grounds. Their assignment, to resurrect for the United States what they had earlier created for Germany, the V-2 rocket.
There is a sensation when a rocket goes that you can't describe. It just felt like it, the momentum of it just pulled your insides out and like you were going up with it. It was just really strong, and it was something that I'll never forget.
They turned on the 7-ton stage, which is the preliminary for testing the burning, and it was deafening, even that. We had cotton in our ears and opened our mouths and all, it was just deafening. And when they turned on the 28-ton stage, it was unimaginable. Like 50 freight trains concentrated in one spot. And the vibration, the noise so good, it just shook our bodies like a cat shaking a mouse. And that was some experience, I'll tell you.
Wernher von Braun, who became known as the father of the American space rocket program, was in World War II chief engineer of the German V-2 missile plant at Peenemünde. Upon his capture at war's end, he was recruited to serve in the same capacity for the United States at White Sands.
Von Braun was a man who was very courteous at all times. They would come in the morning and they would click their heels and bow from their waist and say, "Good morning, Frau Hockum." It made me feel good because they were always so very courteous.
Wernher von Braun was obviously a very intelligent person and egotistical and the leader. And of course, part of that goes back to that Prussian or German society that he was raised in. But I'm told that many times they brought their lunches and their briefcases, and no one opened their briefcase until Wernher opened his.
He had a very rigid caste idea in his head. He would determine who was worthy of his attention and who was not. And if you didn't fit, it was tough.
He was obviously an excellent public relations individual for selling his ideas, his program, his people. And he not only did that in Nazi Germany, he did that in this nation.
Ironically, the scientific foundations upon which the V-2 rocket was based had been pioneered 15 years earlier near Roswell, New Mexico, by the famed American scientist Robert Goddard. Even more ironic, American officials had ignored, indeed ridiculed, Goddard's theories. Germany had not.
Due to the Treaty of Versailles in World War I, the Germans were prohibited from having any equivalent powerful artillery. Well, there was nothing said about rocketry, so this was a way out of their predicament. And that's why they took an interest in it. There was no international regulation forbidding it.
Well, I think the German interest was in space travel. And I think that was their real impetus. Almost the entire von Braun crew was space travel, not weapons. And there apparently just wasn't a group of Americans that were that interested in space travel.
Now, they had the same thing happen in the airplane. After Wright brothers, who developed in the fighting machine? Germany, not the United States. We are slow appreciating these inventions. I don't know why that is in America, but it's happened again and again.
What's wrong with us?
I don't know. Not enough imagination, I guess.
Although disinterested in Goddard's work prior to World War II, the United States changed its tune after the war. Rumor was the German rocket team had been at work on a transatlantic ballistic missile capable of delivering a warhead on New York City.
They had the know-how already, and a lot of the plans, I don't think they really had gotten very far in building that particular missile.
The White Sands missile range is vastly different today from the White Sands which headquartered von Braun and his fellow German scientist. Located in the Tularosa Basin near Alamogordo, and named for the nearby National Monument, at 2 million acres, it is the largest military reservation in the United States, employing more than 8,500 military and civilian personnel. In 1982, the landing site for the third Columbia space shuttle mission.
Okay, Columbia, welcome home. That was a beautiful job.
White Sands, of course, has a history of dramatic events. Just 1 week before Trinity, White Sands Proving Grounds had opened its doors, and already General Electric, under contract to the United States Army, was at work on a long-range guided missile program, the Hermes. Ultimately, however, it was the knowledge and experience of the Germans which would prove critical.
The United States contracted with General Electric to actually fire the captured V-2s.
From 1947 and for 30 years thereafter, Frank Hemingway managed the White Sands Range as its technical director.
But the Germans were given the job in the first three firings, at least, of putting them together and showing General Electric really how the system worked.
Dr. Clyde Tombaugh, in 1930, at the age of 24, discovered the planet Pluto. And beginning in 1946, the famed American scientist headed the Optical Tracking Ballistics Laboratory at the White Sands Proving Grounds.
Clyde, tell me about these people, these German scientists. Who were they? Why were they so important in the world of rocketry?
Well, they were very gifted men to start with, very intelligent, well-educated. And, of course, the war was an impetus to try to excel in development of effective rocketry. And they were just top-notch, capable people who understood this problem. And the United States was fortunate that they placed themselves in a position where they could be captured by the American troops. That was greatly to our benefit. And so that's how they got here. And of course, they helped us a great deal. I hesitate to guess how much they saved us in dollar development and time by their presence here.
We, the Americans, had a lot of trouble with our precision instruments. And we hated to ask the Germans for advice on anything, but they never seemed to have any trouble. And so finally, Pappy went to them and said, how come you don't have trouble and we do? And they said, that's easy. We wrap them in condoms in the evening. And he said he didn't know why he'd never thought of it, but he sent somebody to Las Cruces and somebody to El Paso to buy all they could find. And the solution was great, worked fine, but when they got the bill back at GE, they sent it right back and said, if you think with you clowns down the border, we're billing Uncle Sam for whatever the quantity was, you're wrong. And so he said, this is where American ingenuity came to the fore, because they put their heads together and they resubmitted the bill as rubber tubing 6 inches long, closed in one end, that went right through, and Uncle Sam paid it without a question.
Call it ingenuity, call it end-running the system, but cutting through the red tape was not uncommon in getting America's missile program off the ground.
One person would have too many electronic engineers. Another person would not have enough mathematicians. And so we would trade back and forth. And when we got to a point to where that we couldn't decide who would take which, we'd flip coins. Now, the potential employees never knew this, but the general never knew it either.
Bucking the bureaucracy was the easy part. But even the most enterprising could not buck the laws of gravity.
The local people weren't at all happy about this proven ground coming here. The local Priestley was editor of the Sun News, and boy, he lambasted the missile range of proven ground then. And so this one time they decided to reassure them by inviting them out to watch a shoot. That's the day that the V-2 fell off the launcher and scattered, and they all hit the brush, and some of the women were still complaining they tore their nylons, which were still very precious in 1947. And they went back to town, and Priestley wrote the worst editorial about, let's get rid of this thing that's a danger to our community.
The first missile designed by Von Braun's group out of Fort Bliss, somehow or other, the gyros were hooked up backwards, and it flew exactly its trajectory, but it went south. I was in the blockhouse at the time and listened and saw the consternation that occurred when the flight director asked the safety people what was going on and got nothing back but German over the telephone line, which he couldn't understand.
I was living in El Paso at this particular time, and we saw something go over, and I said, I wonder what that was, and my husband said, I think that's a rocket, and I said, no way, they'll never let those rockets get away like that, they'll keep them from going there, and he said, no, I think that's what it was. Sure enough, when we looked in the paper next morning, that's what it was.
And we could see the impact flash from the launcher. I remember it very well.
They assured me that it was perfectly safe because it fell in the cemetery and everybody was already dead.
Much to the dismay of many, Juarez was not the only missile mishap.
Rather, one of the Hermes, they fired a low trajectory on purpose for a certain test. And then somehow something happened to one of the vanes that it got turned around and came right square towards us doing this, you see. And at one of the places, right square to our stay where I was, you see, and I was pretty worried there for a while. Fortunately, it plunged in the earth about a half mile before it got to us, but it could have been a disaster.
So it was dangerous work.
Yeah, well, we were thinking about getting behind some boondocks there, hoping it'd go over and not land right where we were.
You would hear the range controller say, we now have a reported impact, and everybody was always elated when it was in the area where it was supposed to be.
When that siren blew, the three-minute whistle, four missile went, every office, every place in there evacuated. You went out to watch. And if you were lucky, the thing actually took off. Didn't fall off the launcher. It didn't blow up.
It went straight up into the atmosphere and came right straight down. They fired it from the Army blockhouse. And according to all of the radar from C Station, they came, that was supposed to have come right down on top of the station in which I was operating. But to my benefit, it missed.
Yeah, if you've seen a V-2 launch, you know they very slowly climb straight up in the air. This one did just as it was supposed to for a while, and then it started marching right back down the path it had just gone. Came down on the launcher, burst the tanks, mixed all that fuel and oxidizer, and one big explosion again.
And I was watching the missile. It had gone up and came swinging down. I was watching through the binoculars, and I thought, boy, that looks big. These binoculars are great. Took the binoculars down just when the thing hit right at the guard gate. Wham! Blew all the windows out of post engineer. It was fun. Great fun.
And I might add to these failures that there was one V-2 that scattered parts just about where we're sitting right now. It was 2 weeks after the Hermes 2 went to Juarez, and a V-2 came headed for Alamogordo and actually overflew and landed between Alamogordo and Tularosa. I recall, once again, being in a blockhouse when shortly after the firing, we got a call from a lady who said she was calling from the corner drugstore that parts of our missile had just landed in her backyard.
This was a two-man tracking instrument. One guy would track azimuth and one in elevation, and we stayed on this object for quite a while, several seconds. And the other tracker says, are you tracking? Are you moving? I says, no. Are you moving? He says, no. He says, well, what are we what do you think we got? And I says, I don't know. I can see it. Can you? He says, yeah, I can see it. Well, it turned out to be Venus.
None of us were really ever afraid of getting hit. It was just, you knew it could happen. You saw them land, you know, right there at the gate, but we just weren't afraid. Maybe, I think people here in this area don't worry as much about nuclear bombs as they do, say, back east, because we live with this kind of thing where it could blow you up any minute.
And this was always the problem with the V-2s. As old as they were, as poorly as they had been treated environmentally in their transport from Europe to the United States, they weren't very reliable.
We had a Navy commander at that time that every time that they get ready to fire the lacrosse, I'd bet him a martini it wouldn't go, and they'd get down to under 10, they'd go 9, 8, 7, and somebody'd say, hold, hold, and then finally they just threw me out of range control completely when lacrosse fired. But when the Navy commander left, he owed me about a bucket of martinis.
One particular missile, I believe, went to the launcher 5 times over a total of a little better than a year before it finally got launched.
When a missile did what it was supposed to do, we all cheered, everybody, us secretaries, all of us, because we really felt a part of it. Every failure was celebrated by a number of beers, and every success was celebrated by a number of beers.
The Little Old Officers Club, that was a gym down there. Oh, that was a small place. Everybody went there, civilians and military alike. And as soon as the whistle blew, we hit the steps of the Officers Club. It was a fun place.
I think it was an exciting time. I was down to White Sands with the first party in March of 45 while I was still in the Army. And I did not intend to come back after I got out of the Army. 4 years in the Army, and I had a job in the broadcasting business waiting for me. And the lure of the job brought me back. First, I agreed to come back for a year. I stayed for 30-some. But so I think that tells you that there was a lot of challenge.
The excitement of what you were doing was you were plowing new ground, doing something that was unusual, new in technology, and on the periphery of the leading edge, and it was a really exciting time.
In the early days, everyone that was anyone wanted to say they had been at White Sands, the leading edge, new frontier. And I find in reading the old newspapers and things where Harry James and Betty Grable entertained at the Officers Club, as near as I can tell, free, just to say they had been there.
Over the period of within the first 3 years, they had progressed to where one missile could boost a second missile. And the day that the missile went 153 miles up was a day of the most hysterical joy I ever remember. Nobody really waited till 4:15 when we were officially closed. The men came into the Officers Club walking 2 feet off the floor, hugging one another, singing and shouting, "We did it, we did it." You don't find this when you work at an insurance office. This was just great.
The post was fun in those days. We would go to work. Our annual leave and our sick leave, we had buku of it because no one wanted to stay home for fear they'd miss something.
You see all these lights up there at night? They invariably would have one about 2 in the morning.
Right.
So we'd be working out. It was beautiful. And then this is in the days when you were dreaming about the moon or something.
Oh, yeah.
But it was terribly exciting.
To me, to a college kid who is 19, 20 years old at that time, would be having the opportunity to be thrown into the middle of something exciting like this.
And believe you me, this was fun. This was the most satisfying tour I ever had anywhere.
We watched the space age come in, and it's a great feeling to have been part of this. Maybe it's nothing much to leave to your grandchildren, but it's very satisfying to me.
The German scientists are all gone now, and the young American pioneers of this nation's early space program are in their golden years, at least those who remain. But the once silent and always desolate landscape which became the White Sands Missile Range echoes still to the vitality of those earlier times.
I don't know, a very enjoyable period of my life. I would like to live part of those days over again.
And thank you for joining us on this late Wednesday edition of News 7.
How long do you expect to keep your car? 5, 10 years? How about 52 years? News 7's Casey O'Brien reports an El Pasoan recently raced cross-country in his 36 Packard.
Why, it's Ron Haislett's 1936 Packard coming down the street. It's a classic car. But more than just a classic, Haislett's Packard is a winner. Together, they've won the 4,600-mile Great American Race 3 times in the last 6 years. But this race rewards accuracy, not speed. Each 400-mile day on the road is timed by officials, and the winners come pretty close to perfection.
10 to 12 seconds each day. That's the winning score. A few days might be a little different, maybe 15 seconds, but it's very low error as far as the amount of seconds you're off for the entire day. That's 400 miles.
Together with his navigator, Ron piles into the Packard coupe to take that day's 11 to 12 hour chunk out of the Disneyland to Boston rally course route.
You're with your navigator. What do you talk about all day?
Well, we talk about the event. We're competing for the entire time, except for when we stop for fuel or lunch.
This precision, though, has its rewards. Thanks to sponsors, there are cash prizes for the winners. And thanks to the growing interest in this sport, big plans for the future.
They're going into other events now, and they're going to have more events. In fact, they're talking about a round-the-world event, recreating the original Great Race.
And if that race is as good as the movie, you may just see a lot more 1936 Packards out on the road. Casey O'Brien, News 7 Sports.
At what point does a car go from a junk heap to a classic? There must be a certain number of years there, 10, 12. After 15 years, you no longer own a wreck, you own a classic.
Yeah, my car's never made that transition. I don't think it ever will. Thank you.